Բարևձեզ։ Գրադարանում այսօր զրուցում ենք Guardian Institute-ի նախագիր Եվգենի Մորոզովի հետ։ Hello, Yevgeny.
Hi.
Do you follow Armenian Velvet Revolution because of its tech, use of tech and social media?
Well, sure. It's one of the most exciting events of 2019. I have followed it quite closely from the outside, and I've been quite impressed also, not least because this seems to be finally a positive story, at least on the surface, coming out of these events.
Social media was one of the main tools for this revolution. Mm-hmm. So use of social media for the revolution, is it for good or for, mm-hmm. for is positive or negative?
So well, I've always been calling people's attention to the contextual factors that are always responsible for political and social change. And I would argue that it's these contextual factors, you know, the weakness of the government, the exact positioning of the military and the, you know, police forces, that by and large determine the outcome of any big protest, right? It can go either way. Social media, of course, changes the dynamics quite significantly to some extent, because clearly there is more visibility to the protest, but the downside is that they're much easier to monitor. And I would argue that in the abstract, it's very dangerous to be drawing lessons, because, you know, a successful revolution in one place, just because it involves social media, would not necessarily translate into an effective and successful revolution elsewhere. And even if it does, it's not at all guaranteed that you would be able to consolidate those democratic transformations into an actual functioning democracy. We have seen that in the example of Egypt after Arab Spring. So I think we have to be cautious. We have to celebrate the role of social media where it did play it, but we have to be very cautious about trying to draw some lessons from it.
Head of revolution now, Prime Minister Nikol Pashinyan, knows very well how to use media and how, he's former journalist as well, mm-hmm. how to use media and how to use social media. So is there any danger that he will use it not always for good changes?
Mm-hmm. Well, there is that danger with any politician, right? Especially with the latest generation of politicians who suddenly discovered that they can talk directly to the people bypassing various intermediary institutions, including, by the way, bypassing journalists. Right, so I'm not saying at all that that would be the case or is the case in Armenia, but I think that just the theoretical possibility that we always have to keep in mind, and we have to understand that by and large there is always a danger of opening up to this more populist, occasionally more demagogic type of discourse which social media makes possible. Does not make it necessarily prevalent or dominant, but it makes it possible, and then it's up to the political and media culture of every country to keep that in check, right? It's not a given that or everything has to go to the level of Trump, for example, right? You can also have much more reserved leaders with dignity and modesty using the very same social media as well, perhaps not as successfully in mobilizing people against an enemy or against some object of hatred, but nonetheless we should also be looking at this more reserved uses of it and perhaps try to build checks and balances if needed into how our democracies function to prevent the usurpation of this media by these populist leaders. And I hope it does not happen in Armenia.
Why we have situations when you know, with the use of social media, with the use of media and other tech tools, in some countries some opposition succeed to make changes, or there are some positive changes, mm-hmm. but in some countries, no way, no changes. Like for post-Soviet countries, like in Belarus, where there is very developed tech and IT sure. industry, mm-hmm. but still no positive changes. In Russia, or in,
yeah.
So why it is in one country, there is success, in other countries, success, I mean changes.
Yeah, well, because I think it's a very simple answer, because all countries are different, they have different composition of political forces, different alliances, different susceptibility to, you know, revolutionary change. Those things are not really determined by technology. They're mostly determined by the military composition, by economics, by trade, by all sorts of international alliances a country can build. Technology can play an accelerating and an amplifying role. But I think it would be too naive to expect that technology could be the cause of a revolution. That's why any explanation that puts social media first or digital technology first, it's a completely mistaken. You know, you look at China now, and you know, it's despite the events in Hong Kong, it's a increasingly sophisticated country technologically, yet, you know, the Central Communist Party still enjoys quite a bit of support, right? And I would argue that that's not just a matter of them controlling the digital media, it's also a matter of just how the power of the Communist Party operates, which is not built entirely just on digital foundations.
What kind of society we should have, what kind of society to serve technology for the growth of democracy? Mm-hmm. The connection between society, democracy, yeah, and the technology.
How to? Well, I think, you know, having societies that know how to engage in meaningful debate and to do it openly and to do it in a way that does not identify easy enemies or scapegoats is a good place to start. I think doing it in a way that also leaves some political space for their opponents to mobilize and to mount an opposition and to do it without the risk of going into prison is usually a good start. Building strong civil society institutions, media, the judiciary, and so forth, I think is another prerequisite. In many countries, of course, this is still missing, but there is a lot of work to be done. And I hope that by drawing on some of the successful experiences with digital media elsewhere, some of those changes can be facilitated.
After we've seen like Trump election, we've seen Brexit, do societies learn their lessons?
Sure. Well, it's a mixed bag. I think in some countries there is clearly less desire for leaving the European Union after seeing the mess that is Brexit. In other countries, you have far-right populist forces that basically use the same tactics and techniques that Trump have used, and they are riding very high in the polls. So it's a double-edged sword. There is no, you know, there is no template, and there is no single solution that, you know, we can expect that now suddenly everybody will wake up and they will understand that Brexit is bad or whatever. You know, there are entrepreneurs, including political entrepreneurs, who try to capitalize on those trends. And until those entrepreneurs can act and mobilize society, often in disingenuous ways, we will still see some turmoil.
Thank you for the conversation.
Sure, thank you.